Yo, guys, welcome back to another video. Today's video, of course, will be Scott Pilgrim. And for those who don't know what Scott Pilgrim is, it's pretty much one of my favorite series of all time. Possibly the best one I ever read, to be honest, besides One Piece. Like, the best graphic novel I've ever read, you know? And, pretty much, it's about a guy named Scott Pilgrim. He pretty much is a 24-year-old. And, you know, he's a 24-year-old that doesn't have his life together, right? And basically, he's in a band that sucks. But he pretty much has to defeat seven evil exes. Jesus Christ, I cannot talk today. Sorry, I just woke up. So Scott pretty much has to fight our girlfriends, you know, seven evil exes, which is pretty much the girl of his dreams. Literally, the girl of his dreams, Ramona Flowers. So that's pretty much like, it's a simple thing, right? It's a simple thing. But this entire series goes a lot deeper than that, and some people like downplay Scott tremendously, which is weird. Like, huh? Only moon level? Huh? That don't sound right. So I'm about to break down everything about Scott Pilgrim, the cosmology, and pretty much where he scales at. So let's just get into this. Scott Pilgrim is a character that is, well, he has weird abilities, and I'm pretty much about to break down what his abilities are and where they came from, because some people just don't know about the power system of the series. So just know that I will be breaking down like each like volume of Scott, because he does get more powerful than this, of course. So, but yeah, just keep it on, right? Keep that in mind. So, pretty much, Scott, he's very strong, right? He's a very strong individual. Like, this character, and like, in Volume 1, literally was stated to punch a man around the planet. So, literally punch a man around the planet is, like, it's been calculated to be, like, multi-city block level. But, he can potentially be even higher than this with just willpower alone. So there's that. Now there was the other time that Scott was able to fight against a character named Todd Ingram. Todd Ingram, it's been stated that pretty much he punched the moon, right? And some people, that's what people got Scott's Pilgrim scaling at, moon level, because Todd was able to punch the moon, and it was like 30 pages of tidal waves, which is calculated to be planetary range. So like, pretty much with the shock waves alone of his punches, pretty much causes a planetary like a planetary range of damage. So that's like planetary punches, and people just want to downplay that. First of all, to get the misconceptions and downplay out of the way, outliers out of the way, let me go break down the things. So Todd being continental through exclusively Vingan powers is narratively untrue, and pretty much his Vingan powers not scaling to a standard AP is baseless, right? And Scott with friends not scaling due to the outlier dismissal misunderstands what an outlier is and ignores the supporting feats of scaling. Now, Scott losing to Todd Ingram was simply due to be unable to get close to finish the fight, which he directly says at the end of the fight. So, for people that's gonna downplay Sky through the by the end of this video, just know that that is a it's an understanding. So no, Todd holding back was never been established, so don't even try that. And he contradicts how he acts later in the volume. So yeah, pretty much Scott feats against Todd is valid. And Scott states that each battle gets harder and harder from each X. So it is like, which is like backed by him needing to power up and, you know, get statistics implication. Jesus Christ. Like I said, I just woke up. My brain needs to wake up. He needs statistic implications to compete with them in the base game like laws in this universe. So yeah, that's pretty much gotta go over there. And plus also Scott Pilgrim's media supports the two scalings rather than what Brian says, and the later character interacts with Gideon Graves, so further supports this notion. So get those misconceptions out of the way. All right. So just know that Scott is a lot more powerful than you think. Dude is able to punch a man around the planet, fight against Todd Ingram that has planetary punches, which makes Scott already planetary before the end of the series. On the actually people, I might be wrong that that's planetary range with the shockwaves of the punches, but the punches themselves is pretty much like continental or multi-continental, because he's able to punch a hole, like we able to punch a hole in the moon. So it's kind of like continental, right? I mean, he's able to make a large hole in the moon, right? Twice. He did this twice. Twice. And despite never being able to get many hits on Todd with his vegan powers in use, Todd still consistently shown to need to avoid Scott's hits while even using his vegan powers. So yeah, Scott is like continental plus, at least. Like, come on, continental plus at least. Now he does get the power of love, which is this is one of his statistic implications, is leveling up. So he gained a level up and was able to defeat Roxanne Richer in a single blow, right? Roxanne is pretty much also continental, you know, and pretty much since each exit gets progressively stronger, she should be superior to Todd Ingram, which is like whoever punched a hole in the moon and caused like waves on Earth. That's twice, and fought evenly with Mr. Chow, who scared Scott with his raw power and even cut through Scott's subspace avatar with relative ease. This will make her at least continental plus as well. And Scott was stated like, yeah, I can't really beat her, and he needed a level up to beat her. So yeah, Scott is even further into continental plus. So so yeah, pretty much he's able to one shot her with his leveling up abilities. So yes, leveling up makes you stronger. Yes. Now he does have willpower. He does have willpower abilities, or amplification or something like that, because even while getting beaten down and feeling emotionally defeated, he empowered himself with the thought of Ramona Flowers waiting for him, and he one-shot the Kata twins. Pretty much these two, the twins, are able to access the subspace of the real world, and naturally require a strong will and the determination to control them. So Scott's willpower literally overpowered theirs. So like, Yeah. So he can be scaled higher. He'd be scaled even higher with willpower. So with even higher willpower, that should get him at least around multi-continental, at least with willpower. And this is only like Scott in the real Scott, and not the subspace avatar Scott. I will get into the subspace and why, how completely different that is. But right now, Scott should be multi-continental right now. Now let's talk about Scott's speed. Now his speed should be at least, I'm gonna go over travel speed, combat speed, and reaction speed, because they're all completely different. Travel speed, we don't know, okay? But he is at least faster than the eye can track, which is like, what, is it subsonic level? I guess, I think that was like subsonic level right there. He should be massively hypersonic, considering he's fighting against Todd and everybody. I think Todd flew to the moon. I think he flew to the moon within seconds. That could be relativistic plus. I'm not sure. But Scott scaled to this. So, like, Scott should be relativistic plus right there. I think this is, like, in terms of combat speed, but not travel speed. But, yeah. Pretty much, in subspace, it's completely different. But, yeah. With the power of love, his speed gets even faster, and with willpower, even higher than that. So, pretty much faster than I can track. I think it's like subsonic level. I'm not sure. Now, combat speed, he's definitely relativistic. He should be relativistic plus with willpower. The power of love should be even higher than that in relativistic plus. So, yeah. So, the only reason I'm saying this is because he pretty much tagged Todd Ingram and even hit him once. That caused like great damage to him, which Todd was able to jump to the moon, was calculated at least to be, it's actually being calculated that him leaping to the moon can be at the low end faster than light, and high end should be relativistic. So he should be at least relativistic or two faster than light. So yeah. And also the shock waves, like, look, this is how pretty much the speed go for Todd Ingram. Okay, leaping to the moon should be relativistic or at least faster than light. How much faster than light? It should be 1.28, I think, times the speed of light or something like that. I'm not sure. So, like, pretty much, you know, relativistic to faster than light by jumping to the moon, he should, with his shock waves, the calculation for this is when the shock wave was able to return to Earth, it's been calculated that the shock waves heading to Earth and causing like tidal waves is pretty much around at least faster than light as well. So the shockwaves are at least faster than light as well. So how, I bet y'all wondering, how the fuck shockwaves can be faster than light? It's, hey, he's able to cause damage to the planet. So like, come on now. So like, in terms of the comics, you have everyone post volume 3 scale to Todd Ingram and upscales accordingly. And due to the stats amplification being incredibly vague, I don't see him doubling or tripling tops, you know, Scott's base speed. But in the movie, Gideon got a 7x boost multiplier, which makes him several times faster than light. So Scott is 7x faster than light within the movie. Ah, shit. So, yeah. That's Scott's pretty much speed. He should be relativistic to faster than light in combat speed. So, yeah. Reaction speed should scale to his combat speed. Enough said. You know, also subspace works differently. I'm about to get into that. Now that we got that out of the way, let's go over Scott's abilities before I go into his, you know, hacks, right? So pretty much his innate abilities is fucking insane because all the shit he can do within the series and the games. But I think that's also canon. I think the games are canon. Yeah, I think the games are canon. But yeah. So I already went over his willpower right there. Pretty much, he's basically good at martial arts. He's pretty much remarked as the best fighter in all province. Shown skill in close quarters combat. And he's a master in weapons. I mean, he took a longsword proficiency in grade 5. So, like, in 5th grade, he took longsword proficiency. And he can use his sword as a blunt weapon. So, yeah. his attacks could create electrical shockwaves on impact with his foes. And he can stay long enough in the air to perform a 64-hit combo in the locks of Matthew Patel. So, yeah, that's kind of like a flight right there. Kind of. Now, he also can create a force field that blocks all of Matthew's and his demon hipster chick's fireballs. Which means, well, not only that, but he can also nullify their abilities as well. Because with the Broadway force, he can use his rhythms to outseeing Matthew and completely prevent him from attacking back. So yeah, it nullifies your abilities and paralyzes you as well. Now within this universe, Scott's abilities is completely insane, but like nobody actually takes notice to this. But Scott does have cartoon physics and is able to break the fourth wall. So yes, cartoon physics, breaking the fourth wall. Minor precognition and clairvoyance. So yeah, he has those abilities as well. Scott was aware that he was in a comic book. He already knows how the future events of the comics will play out due to reading his own story. Yeah, that's yeah. So good luck with the plot manipulation stuff because he already knows. Now, like Ramona, Scott was able to imp to the glow, the mental warfare based abilities and use them for himself. So, yeah, it's like a reactive power level ability. But I would get into the glow and what that is. Now, whenever Scott beats an X, they transform into Canadian currency. And pretty much turn one of Roxanne's ninja clothes into a coupon by accidentally kicking her. So yeah, he can pretty much transmutate you if he defeats you. That's pretty much what happens. I mean, that's what happens in video games too, because they turn into like an item you can pick up. So yeah, that's a and you know, after pretty much he defeats evil exes, they respond to their homes having learned their lessons. So yes, all the ex that he kills respawns. They respawn back to their homes and they learn their lessons. So pretty much, so that's like a BFR and empathetic manipulation right there. Now, he has some kind of limited invulnerability here because Scott stated that he cannot kill himself or those he consider friends due to friendly fire not existing. And he can die to bad guys, however. So, yeah, Scott cannot kill himself. So, like, if Scott would have jumped off a building, he would survive. He won't die. Or he tried to get Scott to kill himself. Like mind manipulation or something like that, it won't work. He can't kill himself. Friendly fire does not exist. So yeah, he does have some kind of like invulnerability towards himself. So yeah. Now, Scott can access and give a save point to like any video game. So just like Undertale, He has a save and load and time manipulation. So yeah, he can save and load. Interesting, right? Now, this is about to get really trippy here. Okay? Pay attention. So, subspace can shape reality to the user's liking. And like an example being Scott Pilgrim and the various video game-like aspects of the world, which is a result of subspace and its perceptive space abilities. Now, the potent subspace user can use the perspective-based abilities of subspace to overwrite reality to fit however they view it in the real world. And pretty much, within the subspace, you have an avatar. And an avatar is in subspace. They unconsciously create an avatar in the subspace, right? So yeah. Now, death is like, now pretty much, actually no, I'm about to explain what subspace is. So subspace literally gives you the ability to shape reality as you see fit. It gives you the ability to manipulate laws, to manipulate perspective and observation. Now, pretty much, characters that can manifest doors directly to subspace or even move between subspace in the real world through sheer force has the ability to have dimensional travel and time-space manipulation. And you can even break the walls between subspace and the main universe as well. Now, pretty much, Scott does have this. He has access to subspace, right? And pretty much, if you kill their subspace avatar, you can kill their true form in the process. So, you kill them in subspace, you kill them in the real world. They will never be revived. That's irreversible damage, right? Irreversible damage. So not only that, that's fucking crazy. Just know that pretty much death is treated as an inconvenience in the universe, with nobody pretty much actually dying, right? No one is actually dying. I believe somebody asked like a question, like, hey, along lines of the thought bubble thing, was an alternative movie ending in the new reports that a serial killer who thought he was in a video game or something that was going to make it into the comic. The person responded, hello, this serial killer thing was never an actual ending. I think it was a joke that Eggener said in a interview or somewhere. Maybe he was putting a reference in a DVD, in an Easter egg or something, but it was always a joke. Then some fan or blog make a fake newspaper article image of it and says it'll keep going to internet, and then they confuse people and incite people. So no, there is no death or murder in the comic or in the movie, except when, spoiler, Scott dies in that one part, and that death is a metaphor. Scott he can't not die. He does have immortality. Okay. He does have immortality. It's a metaphor. The death is a metaphor. So technically, Scott cannot die. But if you do affect Scott in the, in the mind space, on the subspace, my subspace, then you can kill the true form. Just saying. Also, he can give Gideon the glow, which is like attack reflection. He actually, through the power of subspace, characters can rewrite and manipulate the plot line of their story. And it's also implied through the Scott Pilgrim series that Scott, along with other major characters, are protected by a sort of plot armor
that helps them in dire situations. Such as when Scott says, like, oh, look, an extra life. He literally got an extra life. Or the fact that Scott say, I need a Deus Ex Machina to defeat Tide. And even in the official cards, the card game, which is fucking canon, right? The card game is canon. It's been stated that you can, if one card says, with determination, you may flip one card in the plot line. So, like, he can manipulate the plot. So, he has plot manipulation. Okay? Plot manipulation. Not only that, but whenever the user can imagine at will, can be created in subspace. For instance, Scott manifested his love for Ramona as the power of love, which he could pull it and store in subspace, giving Scott the ability of subjective reality and storage, dimensional storage. And not only that, but as the powers of the creators originate from subspace, they can create portals or summon beings and objects from the subspace. So, pretty much, Scott has reality warping abilities in base. Like, in base form. He does have resistances as well, such as he resists to severe pain. He could take like multiple slashes from Gideon. He pretty much has resistance to mind manipulation because he can survive inside Anna's edge without breaking down, which is a trained psychic like Todd Ingram couldn't do. Who can use 100% of his brain, by the way, and should naturally resist the conventional mind manipulation of his mind harbors subspace. He can manipulate pretty much. He resists sleep. He can resist transmutation. He can resist irreversible damage because when he was being attacked and killed in subspace by Gideon Graves, neither Scott or Ramona died in the real world. So, yeah. He can resist irreversible damage. He can resist getting sealed, corrupted, his memory manipulated, power nullification, because after accepting and absorbing Nega Scott, the Glow's mental warfare abilities was nullified. So, like, Nega Scott... He absorbed Nega Scott, okay? And for those who don't know what the glow is, the glow was stated by Gideon that it is described as a weapon of emotional warfare that seals you within your own mind space to face your issues. And since Scott was able to resolve his issues, because Nega Scott is the manifestation of his issues that you cannot run from or defeat, he's pretty much able to resist power nullification and memory manipulation and empathetic manipulation as well, because Scott already resolved his issues. So yeah, now he's also able to resist pretty much a plot manipulation and existence erasure, because pretty much characters that is unaffected by the events of the plot line being altered and erased entirely. So it's got even scales of this. Even in the card game, there's a cheat code that once draw a card, you may eliminate one card of the plot line. So like with a cheat code, he can delete a plot line. So there. He also has resistances to observation, to law manipulation, space-time manipulation, subjective realities, and that's it. Because even after being reinfected by the glow, severing his connection to subspace, or severing his connection to subspace, he was still able to overpower Gideon for a brief moment. So yes,
that is Scott Pilgrim, people. Scott Pilgrim. Yes, he has more abilities than this, and he's way more powerful than you fucking think.
But before I even wrap this up, let me break down what the fuck the subspace is and how big this place is, okay? How big is subspace? Huh? How big is it? Now, we know subspace is an alternative universe to the regular universe, but there is more to it than just that. It's shown in Brian's other own series, Seconds, is far bigger than we originally thought. For reference, the plot of Seconds revolves around a character named Caddy. Okay, so yeah. So for reference, the plot of Seconds revolves around the character Caddy, using a special species of mushrooms to travel to alternative realities where she redid a specific action. Now, along with this, the character's name, Lise, showed Caddy that, well, like, what changes meant and how they affect those around her. And now, Caddy's single subspace alone managed to fit the entire cosmology of Seconds within her subspace. For those wondering, the tree is a metaphor for branching realities and how every action and inaction creates countless timelines, which is later confirmed by Caddy when she finally understood what the lights around the void meant. And as I stated before, this is a single subspace flowing off every action and inaction in Seconds alone. And because everyone has their own subspace that they unconsciously manipulate, this will apply to each one of them. So for subspace, in a nutshell, subspace is pretty much a highway of reality bending proportions that play in a crucial role in transportating characters to various locations within haste. Now, subspace in and out of ports appear to be marked within Scott Pilgrim's universe with a star, and the quote and unquote subspace highways are quick form of transportation that Ramona uses to deliver Scott his packages. And the highways just so happens to run through Scott's head in several occasions, which causes him to dream of Ramona and meet her in the first place. Now, along with subspace highways, there exists mind subspace. These are directly tied to the mental consciousness in every person, but normally cannot be accessed through a highway running through it or being a master of subspace. These are often what they are shown throughout the entire Scott Pilgrim novels. And it's pretty much as a metaphor for the main characters and play a crucial role in the ending of Volume 6. As they appear throughout Brian's other stories to convey a peculiar message in a metaphoric manner. So this is pretty much what it is. So subspace is pretty much a metaphoric power that can bend reality. Now, while regular space stretches through the universe and bends the presence of gravity, the subspace universe has completely separated laws of physics. So, yeah. The abilities of subspace. If you have subspace, you have the following abilities I'm about to list. So, due to the established of characters having a good deal of abilities both within and outside of subspace, it should be noted that everyone gets these abilities, and it varies depending on the subspace user and how much control they have of subspace. So someone like Stefan and would not have the same amount of abilities as Gillian Graves. Now, as an example, in subspace, abilities such as pretty much the special perspective manipulation, law manipulation, or causality, because subspace is a different space-time where all rules are different, including death. Thus, it makes an extension to a different system of causality. Yeah, it gives you immortality and regeneration, low godly. Because subspace avatars are true avatars of pure cognition of one's true self by extending and can be restored by the true form at will. Now, concepts such as death are irrelevant to them, as if one of them dies, they would just be sent into subspace. And even spirits can freely pass through and from subspace. And all damage done to a subspace avatar means nothing to them. Scott can lose his limbs in subspace and be cut in half, and he will still be perfectly fine. So yes, it gives you at least low godly regeneration, because they can pretty much be restored. If they die, it's irrelevant. They just be in subspace. And we just confirmed that the creators even stated that Scott's death is a metaphor. So he'll just come back to life. Now he does have, it does give you reality warping and mind manipulation powers, as I went over. Yes, pretty much. And it also gives you power nullification, because a user of subspace can completely nullify any connection to an opponent that is subspace, regardless if they are more powerful or not. This is how Ramona was able to expel Gideon despite him being a master of subspace and was able to manipulate anyone's mind. Now this is what you can do inside of subspace. Now what can you do outside of it? Well, it gives you sheer willpower, because those who can access the powers of subspace in the real world naturally require a strong will and determination to control them, as been stated. It gives you a perception manipulation. Pretty much you can rewrite reality to however you fit in the real world. It gives you plot manipulation, subjective reality and dimensional storage, portal creation and summoning, dimensional travel and time-space manipulation, because Scott was able to do this with sheer force. Law manipulation as well, and that's pretty much it. So, yeah. And for those going to say, like, okay, what is this so-called other series canon to Scott Pilgrim? Now, one of the main things Brian's comments is that he tends to insert short Easter eggs from Scott Pilgrim to newer in his newer comics, which since Brian has made all of these verses along with him directly having people like Scott Pilgrim physically appear within this series, it should be fine to consider this canon. So yes, so that is pretty much what subspace is. And if we want to take this to consideration here, Scott Pilgrim with his subspace abilities will give him two multiversal range of abilities. Yes, multiversal range of abilities. And this is goal for everyone, right? This is how big the subspace can be, multiversal. So yes, Scott is multiversal, okay? So yes, that's like with his subspace abilities, okay? The subspace abilities. So this is pretty much what Scott is, and he's more powerful than you think. This character is completely downgrade. It's like, come on. Like, seriously, he can literally just manipulate the subspace to give him more extra life and can bring him back to life after dying. Like, come on. It gives him like extra life, which is pretty much gives him resurrection, restoration, regeneration, low godly, and gives a minor resistance to empathetic manipulation BFR. So yes. So yeah. Pretty much the glow does absolutely nothing to him, because the glow gives you like empower. Well, he can empower himself, right? Empower himself. He's gotta be able to empower himself with this. What the glow pretty much is. Sabu is like emotional warfare, so it's like empathetic and mind manipulation abilities and sealing, and he was able to empower himself with this. The thing is able to pretty much give you the following abilities. The glow, my bad, is, you know, able to give you following abilities. He's able to give you empathetic manipulation, corruption, memory manipulation, duplication, teleportation and dimensional travel, powerful nullification and existing grounding, because Scott was able to use the glow to depower Gideon to base form. And pretty much enchanted perspective manipulation, observation, law manipulation, space-time manipulation, pocket reality manipulation, sub-reality, subjective reality. So this guy was able to empower himself with this to make it even more powerful. So yeah, not to mention that, yeah, Scott was able to one-shot Gideon Graves, who stated he's a master of subspace. And he said he's basically like a god. He could do everything he wants. And Scott just pretty much overpowered and one-shot him. So, like, yeah. Now, Scott, with his subspace, it gives him, like, a teleportation or transportation. Teleport himself through subspace. It pretty much gives him mind subspace, because he pretty much separate realms located in every person's mind. Essentially, their subconscious and whatever they dream takes place. And it appears in nature related that person's personality and emotional state in a person's in real life can influence the respective subspace and vice versa, and can be used to teleport themselves pretty much. And next to that person or being harmed to help them without being physically, you know, being physical with them. So, yeah, Scott's kind of OP. And people, honestly, if Scott is this powerful, he can probably defeat Gojo, okay? He can probably defeat Gojo. So, this is Scott Pilgrim, people. Scott Pilgrim, at the end of the day, should be at least continental plus to multi-continental. And he should be multiversal. I'm pretty sure he could easily destroy a plane. Like, yeah. So he should be multiversal, right? His speed should be hypersonic plus to relativistic plus up to faster than light plus. He should be faster than light plus, if not higher. Okay? If not higher. It should be unknown. Because of pretty much how distance work differently in subspace and time and space works. And pretty much, yeah, the subspace can literally give you, make you as strong as you need to be, right? Because it's your subspace. So pretty much, yeah, the mind subspace allows the users to project their images of themselves and take their forms. The individual who in the subspace resides in retains all power and control within said mind. Through this, the character can shape themselves and subspace to their liking, to all through their thoughts, perspective, and desires. This even happened when Ramona did this shit. So, for people that gonna say, oh, what about Genjutsu does not fucking work. It does not. You would have to affect the entire subspace, which is multiversal, and that's not going to happen. Scott is going to break free from that. I'm sorry. He's going to break free. So, yes. He should be unknown. We don't know how time space works within subspace, but unknown. Plus, he could potentially, with his desires, can be as fast as he wants. So, yeah, it should be unknown. Yeah. His durability should scale to where his attack points is. And pretty much, man, like, this is pretty much Scott Pilgrim. Multiversal. How about that? How about that? Huh? I'm sure in the physical world, his durability is like, yeah, you can kill him. Yes, it's possible to kill Scott Pilgrim, but death is meaningless. It's just a metaphor. He could just come back to life anyway. So if you do kill Scott, he would just come back to life. And then he just like, okay, you know what? I'm tired of this shit. With just sheer willpower, he just becomes more stronger than you think. Like, come on. Yeah, come on. Anyway, people, I think that will be the video. So yeah, let me know what you guys think about this. Scott is way more stronger than you think. Don't downplay him. Like, and don't wink them, okay? Like, don't wink them. But yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. I will see you guys next time. And you guys have a nice day. Peace.